No outposts. We want to get to this debate on time if we can. But thank you so much to all of you for being here today. Thank you. You'll probably do a great job for you.
Good afternoon and welcome from our hosts, the State Bar of Wisconsin, WisPolitics.com, and WISC-TV. We are proud to sponsor this debate between the candidates for Wisconsin's Supreme Court. We also welcome viewers in La Crosse on WKBT-TV, statewide on Wisconsin Eye and Wisconsin Public Radio, and our in-person guests who are joining us this afternoon in the auditorium. On Tuesday, April 4th, Wisconsin voters will choose between these two candidates. One of them will be filling a 10-year seat being vacated when Justice Pat Rogensack retires later this year. Dan Kelly graduated from Regent University Law School, worked as an attorney at various firms before establishing his own practice in 2014. Dan Kelly served as a justice on the state Supreme Court for 4 years after being appointed to the position by then-Governor Scott Walker. Janet Protasiewicz graduated from Marquette Law School. She served more than 25 years as an assistant district attorney in Milwaukee County before being elected to the Milwaukee County bench, where she currently presides over family court. Thanks to both of you for being here today. We appreciate your time very much. Here are the rules for today's debate, to which everyone has agreed. We will have 1 minute opening and closing remarks. We will then, we'll be asking the questions from three journalists. The questions will be directed at each specific candidate, who will then have 1 minute to respond. Now, the other candidate will have a minute to respond, and there will be an opportunity for a 30-second rebuttal if a candidate mentions their opponent by name in the response to the question. The candidates will receive time cues from a monitor, and the order of the responses for the opening and closing remarks was determined before the debate began by a coin toss, and we will begin with Judge Provost Sidwick.
I want to introduce you first to our panelists who will be answering the questions. J.R. Ross is the editor of WisPolitics.com.
Emily Fannin, Capitol correspondent for WDJT, CBS 58 in Milwaukee, and political reporter Will Keneally of WYSC-TV, News 3 Now in Madison. And we will begin with 60-second opening remarks, and we will begin with Judge Protasiewicz.
Thank you very much, and thank you, everyone. I am absolutely delighted to be here with you today. I thank you so very much. Is the timer on the back supposed to be queuing us? Just want to make sure. Is there a countdown?
Yes.
Okay, because I'm not seeing it. I'm not seeing the countdown.
It's green.
And is it going to queue seconds? It's just going to say the 1 minute? All right. So I'm sorry to take everybody's valuable time with that clarification. I was hopeful that we would have a little bit of a countdown. I'm absolutely delighted to be here with all of you today. I'm currently a judge in Milwaukee County. I have been in the Assistant District Attorney's Office for more than a quarter of a century, and I have centered my entire career on being fair and impartial and following the law and upholding the Constitution. So last year when I started thinking about this race, the reason I decided to run for this seat was really pretty simple. I thought our democracy was in peril. Thank you.
Judge Kelly.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for the host for doing this. Thank you for you being here and all those who are watching. I came to Wisconsin 40 years ago to study at Carroll College. Never been here before, didn't know a soul in the state. And yet when I came here, I fell in love with the people of Wisconsin on the very first day because of the very first people that I met. Young family from Sheboygan Falls, and they were the most warm, welcoming, generous people you ever hope to meet. I learned from them that Wisconsinites were the people of the open hand and generous heart. That's one of the reasons it's been such a privilege and an honor to serve you as one of your Supreme Court justices. Now, I'm looking forward to our conversation this afternoon, and I'm hopeful that it'll be helpful to you in deciding who your next Supreme Court justice ought to be.
Thank you,
Justice Kelly. Our first question this afternoon will be from J.R. Ross, and it is for Justice Kelly.
Thank you again both for being here. Please excuse my cold. Justice Kelly, the state of our Wisconsin simply faced a constitutional crisis. They short of prosecutors and public defenders. They lead to erosion of the right to a fair and speedy trial. The court in 2018 voted to increase the hourly rate for court-appointed attorneys, but declined the same for state appointed public defenders. Lawmakers have simply provided a boost. That said, should the court revisit the issue and raise the state-funded public defenders again
to address the shortage of representation for the accused?
Yeah, I think the shortage is critical. And the question about pay belongs, of course, to the legislature. In our form of government, with the separation of powers, questions of expenditures belong to the legislature. And I think that if we do not remedy this shortfall, that the wheels of justice will start to grind slower and slower. And as a result, that'll make our communities less safe and our criminal defendants less able to present their cases when they need to. So I'm looking forward to the possibility of the legislature stepping in and being responsible with this question. Of course, that is not a decision for the court to make. That's a decision for the people of Wisconsin to make in conversation with their legislators.
Thank you, Justice Kelly. Judge Protasiewicz, same question to you.
I absolutely positively believe that public defenders need a higher rate of pay. You know, I just came out of criminal court. I spent 3 years handling homicide and sexual assault cases. Before that, 2 years dealing with really intense drug dealing cases. And I can tell you that the shortfall impacted my courtroom each and every day. Each and every day. The public defender's office would send me a letter and say, "Dear Judge Janet, we contacted 700, 800, 600 potential attorneys to see if we could find someone to represent the accused, and they frequently couldn't. Justice was delayed. We had to adjourn cases over and over and over because there were not enough public defenders or public defender appointments in the system. The rate absolutely has to be raised.
Thank you very much. Our next question is from Emily Fannin, and it will be for Judge Protasiewicz.
Wisconsin Manufacturers and Commerce has spent more than $3 million on ads trying to prevent you from joining the court. Justice Kelly, the state Democratic Party, has transferred at least $2.5 million to your opponent in attempt to defeat you. How can either of you hear cases involving groups so invested in defeating you?
I would say this. I have been very, very clear that we need a recusal rule for our Supreme Court. Extremely clear. I'm also well aware of the amount of money that the Democratic Party has contributed to my campaign, and I have indicated and pledged that I will recuse myself from any case in which the Democratic Party is a party to a case. I think that that's absolutely critical. I would also note that I think we need a strong recusal rule. The last time this issue came before the Supreme Court, my opponent voted against even having a hearing for a recusal rule. We absolutely need a fair recusal rule for our Wisconsin Supreme Court so that the people in the state of Wisconsin can understand and trust their judiciary once again, so they can have integrity in their judiciary. We need that recusal rule, and I will recuse myself on cases involving the Democratic Party.
Justice Kelly, your response.
We have a First Amendment for a very good reason, and it protects a broad and robust conversation. I don't resent at all organizations trying to keep me from coming to the Supreme Court. This is what our Constitution protects. This is the best tradition of democracy in our country. And so as I look at this, I think one of the most important responses to it is to have an understanding of the court's job that insulates it from the effects of anyone's outside interest. And so as I've described time after time, it involves understanding that everyone has political beliefs, but you need to set those aside, and you need to have a methodology so that when you analyze cases and write opinions, that it squeezes out all personal views and personal politics to make sure that the conclusions are commanded by law rather than being infected by personal views.
Our next question is from Will Keneally, and it will be for Justice Kelly.
Justice Kelly, in an interview on primary election night, you said that you would not take money from the state Republican Party. After that, in an appearance after at the Wisconsin Counties Association several weeks later, you said that you would welcome the party support. Are you now accepting funds from the state GOP, and would you hear cases involving the party if elected?
So I'm welcoming anyone's support. I'm not accepting funds from the state GOP. And I think one of the reasons for that is because it gives the appearance that that justice is bought and paid for by the political party. So I reject it. Now, I understand my opponent has been accepting millions of dollars from the Democratic Party in Wisconsin. And I think that presents a major problem going forward. If she were to be elected to the Supreme Court, she would forever afterwards be known as being bought and paid for by the Democratic Party in Wisconsin. And that's why, although I invite support from everyone, I won't accept funds in those kinds of quantities from the Republican Party.
Just briefly, with 15 seconds, do you mind how defining support that you're receiving?
Sure. If they want to go out and have conversations with the people of Wisconsin, encourage them to come out and vote. Now, because of our campaign finances, it has to be reported as an in-kind contribution. But it's really just them doing their thing as
Justice
an organization.
Kelly, I'm sorry,
I think that's entirely.
Your response, Judge Protasiewicz.
Okay, let's talk about bought and paid for and impartial. My opponent was still on the payroll of the Republican Party of the state of Wisconsin in December of 2022. My opponent went on a election, quote, fraud tour sponsored by the Republican Party with Michael Gableman, of all people, Michael Gableman, this summer. In this spring, my opponent has accepted more than $120,000 in payments from the Republican Party, and the topper, the
Judge
real topper.
That's time. Justice Kelly, you have 30 seconds for a rebuttal.
Thanks so much. So first off, you obviously don't know the difference between having a client and being on a payroll.
never been on the payroll of the state party. I've had clients because, as it turns out, I'm a lawyer. And I don't know what you're talking about, going on a tour with Justice Gable. Didn't do any such thing. My client at the time asked me to address various groups around the state about how our election system works, and I was happy to do that. That was part of my job in representing and giving good counsel.
Justice Kelly, that's time. Our next question is for J.R. Ross, and it will go to Judge Protasevich.
Judge Protasevich, you said that you've been very careful to indicate any decision on the anti-4-down abortion ban based on the law, not your personal values. Sorry. Still, Planned Parenthood and Emily's List have endorsed you in this race, and they clearly expect, if elected, you would vote to overturn the law. Why would they be spending so much money on your behalf unless they expect you to swipe down that ban if elected?
First of all, I would say this. I have been very clear about my values to the electorate because I think the electorate deserves to know what a person's values are. Rather than hiding them, I think the electorate deserves to know. I've also been very clear that any decision that I render will be made based solely on the law and the Constitution. I have told everyone I am making no promises to you. No promises. Emily's List has endorsed me. Planned Parenthood has endorsed me. I'm not aware of any campaign contribution from either of those entities. But I can tell you that if my opponent is elected, I can tell you with 100% certainty that 1849 abortion ban will stay on the books. I can tell you that. Take a look at Wisconsin Right to Life's website. There's a picture of him as their endorsed candidate with the language that he has pledged to uphold their values.
Justice Kelly, your response.
Yeah, that's absolutely not true. Once again, so this seems to be a pattern for you, Janet, just telling lies about me. So you don't know what I'm thinking about that abortion ban. You have no idea. These things you do not know. What I know is this. The endorsements that I receive are entirely because of conversations that I have with individuals and organizations in which they ask me, what kind of a justice will you be? And I explain to them at length the role of a jurist instead of talking about politics, which is all
Justice
you
Kelly, that's
do.
Time. Judge Protase with 30-second rebuttal.
I would say, anybody, pull out your phone when you're done and look at the Wisconsin Right to Life's website. You will see his picture. You will see that they indicate that they endorse candidates who pledge to uphold their values. It's right there in writing. Thank you.
Our next question is from Emily Fannin, and it will be for Justice Kelly. Staying on the topic of abortion, Justice Kelly, you have been endorsed by Pro-Life Wisconsin and Wisconsin Right to Life. Both have prerequisites and to earn their endorsements, including a pledge to champion pro-life values. You have accused Judge Protasevich of indicating how she would rule on the state's 1849 criminal abortion ban by talking about her values. Mm-hmm. Haven't you telegraphed how you'd rule by making commitments required to land these endorsements of these two anti-abortion groups?
Absolutely not. So there's a misrepresentation by my opponent about what it takes to get those endorsements. So I had no conversations with those organizations about how I would rule on any issue, including the abortion issue. So their statement about endorsements being dependent on a pledge, that's for legislative endorsements. I'm not a legislator because I don't talk about my politics. I understand what a court is supposed to do, and that's resolving legal questions. So those endorsements had nothing to do with the pledges that are required of those who run for political office. The conversations we had were this. Will you pledge to follow the law? Will you uphold the Constitution? Will you do the job of a justice in simply using existing law to decide the cases that come before the court? And that's the same pledge I make to everyone, regardless of the issue involved that might come before the court. And so they can be confident, just like everyone else in the state, the decision would be based on the law and
that's
not
time. Judge Protase, what's your response?
Well, my response is pretty clear. This is a big room of people. You can be the jurors. You can decide. I've told you what the website says. You've heard what he has to say. I've been also very clear about what my views are, what my personal opinion is in regard to a woman's right to choose. My personal opinion is that should be the woman's right to make the reproductive health decision, period.
Justice Kelly, would you like to respond?
No, that's good.
Okay, our next question is from Will Keneally, and it will go first to Judge Protasiewicz.
So, Judge Protasiewicz, your sentences in several criminal cases have been featured in a string of TV ads in this race. In interviews with a question about those sentences, you said hindsight is 20/20, and that you worked with the facts available at the time in reaching those decisions. Using as an example the case where you gave no prison time to a woman who starved her child, can you explain your thought process in making those sentencing decisions?
I will tell you that those commercials are unfair. My entire life has been rooted in protecting our community, and my sentences as well. I haven't sentenced hundreds, but I have sentenced thousands of people. And it's interesting that a handful of cases have been cherry-picked and selected and twisted, and insufficient facts have been provided to the electorate. I have one case where somebody reoffended. That is the case where I indicated hindsight is 20/20. I have spent my entire career protecting this community as both an assistant district attorney and as a judge. And I can tell you, I would not have been in homicide and sexual assault court for 3 years if the parties, the people, the community, and the rest of my colleagues thought I wasn't handing down sufficient sentences to take care of our community.
So just with 15 seconds here, can you explain your thought process in making those sentences?
Every single case, you look at the serious nature of the crime, the need to protect the public, and the character of the defendant. That is what case law tells you to look at. That is what I evaluate in each and every case.
Justice Kelly, your response.
There's a case in a man raped a 15-year-old. Came to you for sentencing. You said no prison time at all because COVID. There's no way that COVID provides a get-out-of-jail-free card for a man who raped a woman. Another man sexually assaulted a 13-year-old child, videoed himself doing it, posted it to Facebook where it will live forever. Came to you for sentencing. You said no prison time.
That's time. Time is up. Judge Protasiewicz, would you like rebuttal time?
I can tell you that sentences take hours, sometimes half a day, sometimes a day. There is no way I would have said in any case you're not going to prison. COVID, that's an outright lie. I can tell you each and every case where I have sentenced someone, I have evaluated all of the pertinent factors very, very carefully. I'll also tell you in sexual assault cases, those are challenging cases. Those victims frequently don't want to come to court. There are frequent recantations. It's a sophisticated area of law to work in as a judge.
Our next question is from J.R. Ross, and Justice Kelly, you will go first.
Justice Kelly, you'll be sharing the ballot this April. The constitutional amendment on bail reform. Why should judges, or should judges, receive more latitude to set bail at sentencing?
Well, I think it's important that the judicial system have the broadest array of tools to keep communities safe as they go about doing their business. So currently, the Constitution prohibits judges from considering the defendant's criminal record, their danger to society. The constitutional amendment will take away those prohibitions and will allow judges to take those factors into account in setting cash bail. And I think that's it's good and useful change, because what we're trying to do in the criminal justice system is get through the work as quickly and as efficiently as possible, but also in a way that will protect our communities as we do it. So having that ability to consider those aspects of the criminal defendants appearing before them, I think is critical.
Judge Protasiewicz, what's your response?
Yeah, I agree with that. I absolutely agree with that constitutional amendment. You know, as a judge in those courts, very challenging to set bail based solely on the question of whether or not the defendant is going to return to court. Absolutely, other factors should be able to be considered. I actually would go a step further, quite frankly, if I were drafting that, a step further, and allow in certain cases for extremely dangerous offenders to be held in custody without even being able to post bail. So I agree with it, but I go a step further.
Our next question is from Emily Fannin, and Judge Protasiewicz, you'll go first.
We're going to move on to redistricting. Judge Protasiewicz, you pledged to recuse yourself from any case involving the state Democratic Party after it transferred $2.5 million to your campaign. You said the public deserves the appearance of fairness, even if you could be impartial. Still, you said you would sit on a challenge to the current legislative maps drawn by Republicans, even though you called them, quote, rigged. If a challenge is filed, Republican lawmakers would be sure to argue those facts meet requirements under state and federal law. How could they expect to get a fair hearing from you and the appearance of fairness to the public considering your criticism of their maps?
Well, I think the map issue is really kind of easy, actually. I don't think anybody thinks those maps are fair. Anybody. In 2011, Duke University said that the Wisconsin maps are really the playbook for the worst gerrymandered maps in the country. And now they're even worse. So we know that the maps are not fair. We have battleground elections. We know they're not fair. But the question is, am I able to fairly make a decision on a case? Of course I am. It's what I've spent my entire career doing. I follow laws I don't always necessarily like or agree with. You follow the law. That's what you do. I can assure you that every single case that I will ever handle will be rooted in the law 100%. You look at the dissent in that MAPS case. That dissent is what I would tell you I agree with.
Well, there you have it. I think she's just told you how she would resolve the case. See, this is the problem that you have when you have a candidate who does nothing but talk about her personal politics. She's already told each and every one of you how she will approach this. And although she says the formulaic words that she will follow the law, she's never said one thing in this campaign that would lead to any reasonable belief that that's what she would do. See, this is a judicial election. You should be talking about things that the courts do, the Constitution, the rule of law, judicial philosophy, what it takes to be a good jurist, how you do the analysis to squeeze out personal views.
Justice, Judge Protasiewicz, would you like to a 30-second rebuttal?
No, thank you.
Okay, our next question is from Will Keneally and Justice Kelly. You will go first.
So, Justice Kelly, the majority in the redistricting lawsuit set the foundation for the maps submitted to the court. We required a least change approach to the lines drawn by Republicans in 2011. So now, the majority argued that that approach was neutral and apolitical. At the same time, a least change approach does not appear anywhere in the Wisconsin Constitution. So, understanding that you're deferring to those Republican maps, how do you remove the politics from that case when adopting that standard and deciding future cases?
Sure, you decide the legal questions and not the political questions. So the way you draw those lines is almost entirely political, except that there are some legal requirements you have to meet. So if you take a look at, for example, Article 4, Section 4 of our Wisconsin Constitution, it tells us that we have to have equal population. That's a legal standard. It has to be reasonably compact districts. That's a legal standard. Contiguous territory, you have to comply with the Voting Rights Act. These are all legal standards, and because those are legal standards, the court can address those. So I understand the least change phraseology to express the idea that you address the legal questions that relate to the map, but leave the political questions to the legislature where they belong.
Judge Protasiewicz, your response?
Well, my response is that that methodology is totally unfair. We are a battleground state. We have very, very close statewide elections. Yet you look at our state assembly, you look at our state senate, 2/3 of the seats are red. You look at Congress, you know, we have 8 seats, 6 are red, 2 are blue, in a battleground state. So we know something's wrong. We know that this least change rule certainly inhibits people's ability to cast a vote and a vote that counts. We are a representative democracy. Just that, a representative democracy. Everybody's vote should count. And with this least change rule, everybody's vote is not counting. I think it's unfortunate that my opponent sanctions this, quite frankly. Unfortunate.
All right, so this is the picture that you want to see. She just told you that she's going to steal the legislative authority and use that in the courts. Fairness of the maps is a political question. Political questions belong in the legislature. We all know that since grade school with Schoolhouse Rock. But she just told you she's going to take that authority that does not belong to her, that the people of Wisconsin did not give to the judiciary, and she's going to use that to usurp the role of the legislature.
Justice Kelly, that is time. We're going to move on. The next question from J.R. Ross or Judge Protasiewicz.
Judge Protasiewicz, in the past dozen years, we've seen the Supreme Court take cases involving Act 10, voter ID, drop boxes, absentee ballots, the governor's emergency powers, setting precedent
legally speaking, what is your view on precedent established when it's overturned?
Well, precedent, obviously, we all follow precedent all the time. That's what you want to do. You want people to have an ability to understand what a court is likely going to do. You know, that's the rule of law. That's the stare decisis. That's what we all follow. But, you know, precedent changes. It precedent changes over the years. You know, you look back at, you know, separate but equal. And what were we taught in grade school? No separate, always separate, never equal, right? That case was then overturned, Plessy versus Ferguson, with Brown versus the School of Education, school board. You know, precedent changes when things need to change to be fair and work well for absolutely, you know, everybody in our society and everybody in our community. So, of course, we give great, great weight to precedent, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't change from time to time.
Justice Kelly, same question to you.
That answer was entirely unrooted from the law. Stare decisis is the principle that we follow decisions that have been made before to the extent that they're correct. However, if in the wrong hands, stare decisis can become an error propagation doctrine. And we should never follow an opinion that was incorrect when it was made. So the time that you overrule a precedent is when you go back to the original authority, whether it's a statute, a constitutional provision, you compare that precedent to that authoritative statement of the law. And if they don't match, your responsibility as a jurist is to overturn that prior case and do it correctly. We don't want to simply follow what's been done before if we know it's wrong. To do that would just be to propagate errors from now until the end of time. And that's not the rule. And that's not the rule of a court.
Emily Fannin has our next question. Judge Protasiewicz, you will go first. Oh, excuse me. I'm sorry, Justice Kelly. Justice Kelly, you've said in several forums that you expect outside groups to provide significant support through campaign ads. It begs the question of how you know this. Are you or your campaign communicating with independent groups and their intentions in this race? If so, what steps are you taking to ensure you don't violate state laws that allow communications between campaigns and groups, but not coordination?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we have no communication with the outside groups. So what I do is I read the press just like everybody else does, and I see the reports, and I see which organizations and individuals are saying what kind of support they're going to be bringing. And then, of course, we look at things that are also available to the public, ad buys and ad placements and whatnot. And you get a sense of how much money is coming in from that. So I listen to what's publicly said, and that's where I get the information from.
Judge Protasiewicz, same question to you.
That doesn't sound truthful to me. During the primary, Justice Kelly bragged that the money would be following him, that he needed to get through the primary, that the outside money, millions and millions, maybe up to $20 million, would be following him, and not who he considered his opponent in the primary, Judge Doral. So I don't think that the answer that he just provided to this room, quite frankly, is truthful.
And that's because you're not looking at the public record. So they've actually said that in the, it's been reported in the newspaper. So now, again, this is you being quick to lie. This has been apparent in all of your ads against me. It's been apparent every time you speak about me. It's just full of deceit and dishonesty. And I call on you to do better.
JR has the next question, and we will start with Judge Protasiewicz. Oh, excuse me. It's Will. My apologies. Will.
A question on TV advertisements to you, Judge Protasiewicz. In an ad paid for by your campaign, you refer to your opponent as a monster representing individuals who are charged with child sexual crimes. How does that factor when you see similar defendants come before you in your own courtroom?
I'll tell you. That ad was meant for one reason, and that is to point out the hypocrisy of my opponent. That reason. He's going around the state telling people that I'm not tough on crime. My record belies that. I have spent my entire career protecting this community. 25 years in the district attorney's office. 10 years of handling extremely challenging, complicated cases as a circuit court judge. 3 years handling just those kind of cases that we see on TV. So those homicide cases, those sexual assault cases. My only client has ever been the people of the state of Wisconsin. So when a person is doing that, certainly I am going to respond and point out that he has represented some very, very dangerous people.
So thank you for your frankness. I appreciate that. So what you're telling all the state of Wisconsin is that when I tell people about what you've actually done, the sentences that are a matter of public record that they can look up, that your response to that is to lie about me, to slander me, and not only slander me, but slander all attorneys who handle criminal defense cases. What you're telling them, what you're telling all the people of Wisconsin, is that you believe the criminal defense attorneys only take the cases because they like the crimes their clients are accused of committing. So your response to an accurate, fact-filled, truthful expose of your judgment, Janet, has been to lie and slander. And that's a pattern.
Judge Protasiewicz, you have a rebuttal if you want.
Thank you. I built my career on integrity and being truthful. That ad points out just what I was saying earlier. I have a strong respect for the criminal defense bar. My friend who traveled with me is a criminal defense attorney last weekend as I campaigned. My campaign treasurer is a criminal defense attorney. But don't go around slamming someone on community safety when you have defended people that most of the people in this community think should be incarcerated.
JR has the next question for Justice Kelly.
Justice Kelly, the three liberals in the court right now have all endorsed Janet Protasiewicz. All four conservatives now in court served with you, yet only Justice Rebecca Braley has publicly endorsed your campaign. Why have they not really backed your bid to join the court if they're the people who arguably know best your qualifications to justice?
So I'll get to that in just a moment. I just want to follow up with that. Again, that is a remarkable answer. I want everybody to hear it. I want you to bookmark this and listen to it over and over again. So when she says that the reason she did that ad is to point out hypocrisy, there's no hypocrisy there. I represented someone who was accused of a crime. I handled a couple of pretrial matters and I left that firm and went to the one I spent most of my career. But how is it hypocrisy, Janet, to point out your weak on crime sentences and then and have that pointed out by someone who understands and respects the role of the criminal defense attorney? But you don't respect that. Either that or you just don't care and you're willing to say anything to get what you want. Because that ad was slanderous of the entire criminal defense bar. It did not show respect. It showed profound disrespect. I'm sorry, what was your question?
So, 15 seconds. Why the people know you best about endorsing you for this race?
Yeah, so most of the individuals in the so-called constitutionalist bloc of the court generally don't do public endorsements. And I don't have any problem with that. I am thrilled to have the endorsement of Justice Rebecca Braley, who's just a rock star.
Judge Protasiewicz, same question to you, and we will give you an extra 15 seconds as well.
Well, I'm delighted to have the endorsements of, you know, Justice Rebecca Dallet, who's here, Justice Jill Karofsky's here, Justice Ann Walsh Braley, who was not able to join us today, and so many other people, thousands of people across our entire state, community leaders, judges, attorneys. People across our entire state have banded together to endorse my candidacy. And the reason that they have done so is because they believe that I am fair, they believe I am impartial, and they believe I will uphold the law and apply it equally to everyone.
That is time. Thank you. Our next question is from Emily Fannin, and we will begin with Judge Protasiewicz. Judge Protasiewicz, you applied for a judicial appointment twice while Scott Walker was governor. In your applications, you praise conservative jurists such as Pat Robinsack, Antonin Scalia, and Clarence Thomas for their writings advocating against expanding the rights of the accused. Do you truly align with their thinking in the cases you cited, or were you seeking to gain favor with a Republican governor who was making the appointment at that time?
I absolutely agree with what I said in that application. I carefully selected cases that I thought would be appropriate and also talk about what I think in regard to community safety. Those are our community safety cases. I agree with the justices that rendered those decisions. Again, I want to talk to you about community safety and how I have rooted my entire life in that. I want to respond to Dan Kelly's latest comment. I've told you I've sentenced not hundreds, but thousands of people. I know the Republican Party of the state of Wisconsin did an open records request for every case that I touched. And they found a handful that they thought they could use in commercials and use against me. I haven't heard anything about the people that I've sentenced to life terms of imprisonment. I haven't heard anything about people that I've sentenced to decades of imprisonment. I haven't heard anything like that. All I've heard is a sketch of a handful of cases that they thought they could use that against me.
Justice Kelly, same question.
How would you like me to address that? I mean, this is, look, once again, take you up on your cue here, Janet. There's not enough time in this debate. There's not enough time left in the campaign to detail every single one of your cases. So necessarily, people will have to pick out representative ones. But it's the reasoning that goes behind those sentences that's problematic. So when the young man raped his cousin and came to you for sentencing, you gave him a paltry 1 year and 2 months in prison. And then you looked at him, and this is in the sentencing transcript, after the victim had testified how she couldn't work anymore, how she sobbed every day, how her boyfriend had abandoned her as, quote, damaged goods. You looked at him and said you saw a good man in him. And then you said you didn't think he was a danger to society. The woman was his cousin.
Your time is up. Judge Protasiewicz, you have 30 seconds for a rebuttal.
Well, I certainly would like to see that transcript in total. That is certainly doesn't sound like anything that I would do. I've told you that I work very, very hard to keep our community safe. And guess what? I also do see some good in the defendants and the accused who come before our courts. I have worked very hard to keep our community safe each and every day that I am on the bench.
Will Keneally has our next question, and it will go first to Judge Protasiewicz.
Yes, Judge Protasiewicz. Your endorsements and supporters make it clear where your politics lie. With the issue of impartiality being raised by both campaigns, can you think of a case where you disliked the outcome or made a decision that did not align with your beliefs, but where the law applied correctly?
The question does go to Justice Kelly first. We apologize for the order. Do you want us to repeat the question?
No, that's fine. So I generally don't talk about the results that I like or don't like. What I can tell you, though, is that there are those who people think are generally in line with me who don't like some of the decisions that I come to. So, for example, the SEIU versus Voss case, in which the issue there was whether the legislature could control the executive branch promulgation and adoption of guidance documents. And it exerted a significant amount of control over that process. And I looked at that, and Justice Rebecca Bradley looked at that, and we said, that's unconstitutional. Because a guidance document, as described by and defined by statute, was simply the executive's understanding of how the law functions. And the legislature cannot dictate to the executive his understanding of how the law functions. And so we struck that down as unconstitutional, and I understand there are those who did not like that.
Judge Protasiewicz, your response.
You know, when you're in court every day, you have to follow the law. That's what you do as a circuit court judge. You follow the law. You know, we have an expungement statute that I find extremely challenging. Our expungement statute states that at the time of sentencing, the court has to make a determination as to whether or not an offense is going to be expunged, that would be removed from a person's record. That's really hard to do at the time of sentencing. Because what you want to do is give a person an opportunity to be placed on probation or supervision and see if they're actually going to conform their conduct to what you expect them to do. Are they going to do the drug and alcohol treatment you want them to do? Are they going to leave the victim alone? Are they going to come back and pay the restitution that you've ordered them to pay? You know, those are just some examples. Have you done the counseling I want you to do? All of these matters that you could look at after the person has completed that term and make that decision. I don't like that law that I have to make that decision at the time of sentencing.
Time's up. Thank you. JR has the next question, and Judge Protasiewicz, you'll go first.
Judge Protasiewicz, SwissPolitics.com has tracked $33 million in spending so far in this race. That is more than three times the PEP was spent in 2020. It is more than twice the previous national record. We still have a way to go. The tab is also likely to higher if this issue has a hard to track citizen. Do you believe that spending undercuts perception of the independent judiciary? And should the state consider appointing Supreme Court justices rather than elected?
All right, so that's a pretty long question for a one-minute response. I'll tell you this. I'll start off with, I do not think Supreme Court justices should be appointed. And this is why. I've been traveling this entire state for the past year, talking to people, talking to them about their concerns, talking to them about issues that they think are important. And I would not be able to understand them in the same way as I can after I've spoken with people. You know, I've talked with Native Americans on their reservations about how they feel about their land. I've talked with people who own small farms and tell me how they want to pass that farm, it's their only progeny, down generation to generation, but they can't do it if the forever chemicals are in the soil. So I think that, you know, it's a long, bruising process running for one of these seats. We're both doing this for almost a year. It's a long process. I can't think of a better way to do it, though. I really just can't.
Justice Kelly, your response.
So I like the idea that servants, and that's what we are. We are servants, and you all are the bosses. I like the idea that the servants need to come back regularly to their bosses and give a report on what they've done with the authority that they were loaned. Because that's all we do. We use loaned authority to decide your cases. And in the judiciary, it is loaned to us to decide legal questions. It's not for us to have political conversations. It's for us to decide legal questions. The founders set this up so that we separated the law-making function from the law-adjudicating function. And so the conversations we have should follow that. I don't have any problem with the outside groups coming in, having a conversation. What I do want, though, is to have it relevant to the work of the court. Let's talk about the Constitution and the rule of law and judicial philosophy and what a jurist does, not politics.
Emily Fannin has our next question, and Justice Kelly, you will go first.
Justice Kelly, this race has become increasingly partisan, and we have seen justices or candidates for the court appear at political events, such as the state party conventions in recent years. If elected, would you avoid attending or speaking at political or partisan events to maintain the image of impartiality?
Yes, of course. So during elections, what we do is we go to where people gather. And it turns out they gather quite frequently around political organizations and events. And so we follow where the people of Wisconsin go. And so the race has not become politicized on my part, at least, because literally all I do when people ask me about political issues and how I would decide specific issues that come before the court is to tell them that that's not our job. That's a job that belongs to the legislature, which is why I talk about constitutions and constitutional theory. I talk about judicial philosophy. I talk about the rule of law and what that means to our ability to live together in society with freedom and with the prospect of prosperity. And so these are the things that we should be talking about in judicial campaigns as opposed to politics.
Judge Protasiewicz, your response.
My response is absolutely I would not be attending partisan events, but I am running against probably one of the most extreme partisan characters in the history of this state. This is somebody who advised the Republican Party about the fake elector scheme. This is somebody who was running his former office out of the Republican Party headquarters. This is somebody who's given legal advice to the Republican Party over and over and over. But the real cherry on the top is that fake elector scheme. That fake elector scheme. Andrew Hitt, who was the head of the Republican Party, testified in the January 6th hearings that he had extensive conversations with my opponent, extensive conversations with him about the fake electors. He is a true threat to our democracy.
Justice Kelly, you have a 30-second hold on.
Sure. So once again, you're lying. So you might not know this, but the Republican Party had multiple attorneys. His testimony was he had extensive conversations with his attorneys, plural. His testimony was also that he had one conversation with me, 30 minutes,
And when she asked if I was in the loop on the alternate electors slate, I told him I wasn't, because I wasn't. And that was the end of the matter. So I think that what we...
Your time is up. I apologize.
No worries.
Emily? Emily, you have our final question this afternoon.
And we're going to start with Justice Kelly. You have called your opponent a sloppy and irresponsible judge and have accused her most profoundly a dishonest campaign for the court.
Yes.
Judge Protasiewicz, your ads have accused your opponent of being corrupt and putting justice up for sale. In the past dozen years, the court has seen its reputation take a hit with the public. We have had physical altercation between two justices. There have been complaints filed against members of the court over ethics. Considering the tone of this campaign, if elected, how will either of you restore public confidence in the court?
I think first by winning. So when I say that my opponent has told sloppy and irresponsible lies, I mean that in every possible way. So they are false, they are defamatory, and they are incredibly sloppy. And I say they're sloppy because anyone literally in the world with a few taps on the keyboard could find out what the truth is about the lies that she's telling about me. And I say she's irresponsible because we look at the sentences that she has imposed and the reasoning that she used to reach those conclusions. And that's just irresponsible to allow dangerous, convicted criminals back out so easily with no repercussions into the communities they just got done victimizing. Now, as far as conduct going forward, so I've been concentrated 100% on making sure that everything that we say is punctiliously true. And I will continue doing that going forward. It might make my opponent uncomfortable to have the truth told about here, but I will not stop doing it.
Your time is up. Judge Protasiewicz?
Well, I think there are a number of things that we can do to restore the integrity of our Wisconsin Supreme Court. First of all, the justices treating each other, you know, with respect and dignity. Secondly, I think we really need to look at that recusal rule and come up with a rule that we are going to bind ourselves to, so the public starts to believe that we are fair and independent, as we are supposed to be. You know, third, I think we need to start to look at reopening to the public, you know, the conferences that the Supreme Court has. When my opponent was on the Supreme Court, he voted to close a number of the administrative conferences. Those conferences should be open. You know, we need to be transparent. We need to be independent. And I think slowly but surely, the people in the state of Wisconsin will regain confidence in their Supreme Court.
Justice Kelly, you have a 30-second rebuttal. No? Okay, I'm sorry. We're too tight for time now. We're going to go now to closing statements. Each candidate will have 60 seconds to make a closing remark, and Judge Protasiewicz, we'll begin with you.
Again, I wish to thank everybody. I'm sorry I was a little bit off the clock when we started. I haven't had the opportunity to thank my husband, Greg Sell, for being here with me. He has just been a stalwart during the time that I have been running this campaign for the last year. He's just been amazing. But I wish to thank all of you. I hope you'll take the time to fact check what we all said here today. I promise you I will be a fair, impartial justice on your Supreme Court. Thank you so much.
Justice Kelly.
I understand that all the authority that we exercise on the Supreme Court is on loan to us from you. You've loaned it through your Constitution. You've been extraordinarily clear about what we are to do on your behalf. You've told us that we have one job and one job only, and that is to decide your cases according to the existing law, without respect to what we think about that, whether it's wise or effective or not. You've reserved to yourselves the right to change the law in conversation with your legislature, which is why we must not talk about politics as we go about the work of the court. Confidence in the work of the court comes from a sure and certain knowledge that everything we do is concentrated on the law alone, without regard to personal views or personal politics. That has been my commitment as one of your Supreme Court justices. The record of my accomplishment in actually doing that job according to the law, without regard to personal politics, is all in the public record.
Justice Kelly, thank you. With that, we want to thank both of our candidates, Justice Dan Kelly and Judge
Janet Protasiewicz, for being with us today. Thank you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you also to our panelists, J.R. Ross, Emily Fannin, and Tom Bailey. This debate has been sponsored by the State Bar of Wisconsin, WisPolitics.com, and WISC-TV. A reminder, Election Day is Tuesday, April 4th. We encourage you to exercise your right as an American, have your voice heard, and vote on Election Day. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you.